Can everybody stand for the call to worship? When it comes on the screen. God sends the Holy Spirit to remind us, teach us, and guide us. Together we open ourselves to receive the Spirit. God calls us to worship and live in the Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Live in us and live through us. Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Be your name.
Listen to your words. Listen to all you have given us. Open our eyes, open our ears, and especially open our hearts that we may be in tune with you to guide us, to show us the way, to show us your love so that we can show your love to the vast world around us. Thank you, Lord, again for being our Lord, Adonai. Amen.
was just making sure that someone else wasn't coming up. Okay, time for children's moment. Oh, my goodness. Oh, yay. You all came. I waited. I was afraid no one was coming. I was standing at the door earlier. Good morning. Good morning. Oh, hi, Skylar. Come here. Come sit by me. Yeah, pretty girl. Come here. I'm going to scoot over. There we go. Now everybody's together. So this past Wednesday was our last Shine Wednesday night for spring. And we had a wonderful celebration, right? Yeah, we did. It was super awesome. And we kind of talked about things that we had learned this year. And there was one person that was our favorite. And we talked about him. And then we decided that we were going to do things a little different this Sunday morning, huh? I'm not going to lead children's moment. They're going to lead children's moment. And they're going to tell you guys about someone special in the Bible. Do you guys remember who we're going to talk about?
Joseph.
Joseph, that's correct. So who wants to start the story? Anyone want to start? Be the first person? Okay, let's do this. What was something special that Joseph's father gave him?
The robe of many colors.
The robe of many colors. That's right. That's right. Very good. What was something, a gift that Joseph had that he could do that no one else could do? Do you guys remember? It happens when you sleep. You guys remember? Do you remember, Annie?
No.
Dreams. Skylar says dreams. He could interpret dreams. That's right. So what happened to Joseph? What was something really sad that happened to him?
He got thrown in the jail.
He did. He got thrown in jail, and that was really sad, huh? But who was with him the whole time he was in jail?
God.
God, that's right, because God's always with us, right? So, two men got put in jail with Joseph. Does anyone remember who that was?
The wine taste.
The baker.
And the cupbearer, that's right. Do y'all remember anything special about them? Nick?
The skinny cows and the fat cows?
That is part of it, that is right. So someone was having dreams, and they needed someone to interpret those dreams. Do y'all remember who that was? Mm-hmm. Was it the Pharaoh? And then Joseph got out of jail because someone remembered him, right? Yes, okay. And so what were the dreams again that the Pharaoh was having?
The skinny cows and the fat cows.
That's right. Do you know what that meant?
Your name.
My name is Brandy. Do y'all remember what those dreams meant? We talked about that, the skinny cows and the, remember the game we played? You guys remember that? There would be 7 years of good harvest, right?
Yeah.
And then 7 years of, you guys remember? Famine. Okay. So Joseph got out of jail, right? And he helped save Egypt. Yes. And then what happened? Do you guys remember at the end? That was a real big part of the story. Who came back to see Joseph?
No. His brothers.
That's right. And what was something huge that Joseph did for his brothers that we all can learn that we do? For people.
Forgive.
That's a very big part of the story, yes. So, aren't these kids wonderful? Let's give them a hand. Yeah, that was, y'all did so good telling everybody. Was there anything else that just y'all wanted to share this morning? Anyone that didn't have a chance to talk? No? Okay, we're going to pray, okay? I'll bow your heads. Y'all repeat after me, okay?
Dear God,
thank you for loving us.
Thank you for teaching us about so many wonderful people in the Bible and teaching us love and forgiveness. Amen. All right, let's go. We're going to go down to Candyland because we got a lot. That's where we're going today. Candyland.
Okay.
I've already heard the sermon once. I think I'm going to Candyland. Boy, weren't those kids great? I mean, man, I don't know who's been teaching those kids. It surely hadn't been Brandy. It's a joke. It's just a joke. Brandy's wonderful. Well, this morning you have a treat. Kevin Krest is here to speak, and he was here once before, and it was wonderful, and he's going to give you a wonderful word from the Lord this morning, too. So, Kevin, welcome.
After those kids, I'm not sure Steve needed me this morning. I'm not sure what the deal was. So thank you. I'm back again. I was here last year. Some of you might remember about 48 weeks ago, so maybe you don't remember, but I was. I'm Kevin Krest. I'm a certified lay speaker with the United Methodist Church. Since I was here last June, I've been to 13, 14 churches and brought the message 19, 20 times. So it's kind of a part-time gig. I'm a lectionary preacher. I look at the lectionary and I do a new message every time that I have this opportunity. I don't recycle stuff. And so what you're hearing today is fresh, except I just gave it a little earlier, so you got the second one. But that being said, my wife is the pastor at Central Lincoln United Methodist Church and Mara United Methodist Church, and is employed full-time at the University of Arkansas, and I am a part-time writer, semi-retired, and the rest of my job is to make sure that Rachel doesn't go crazy. Sometimes I'm successful. There are times when I'm not. So thank you for having me this morning. I'll also be back on June 19th, I believe. Okay, so our scripture readings this morning, the first one is from Acts, chapter 16, verses 9 through 15. This is from the New Revised Standard Version. There's a new Revised Standard Version that's coming out in print in October. I get my scriptures from Bible Gateway, so this is actually from the new Revised Standard, whatever they're going to call that. And so it might differ a little differently from what you see on the screen. So that's my excuse if I mess things up. So if I read something wrong, I'll just use the excuse that it's a different translation. It's different up there. So this is from Acts. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we immediately cried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home," and she prevailed upon us. Second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 23 through 29. Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. This is the word of God for the people of God this morning. Thanks be to God. So when Steve reached out to me a couple months ago and asked if I could come back and fill in during his travels, I immediately looked at the lectionary reading. This was before I said yes, because if I didn't like the reading, I would just say I was busy. No, just kidding. It doesn't really work that way. But I was actually thrilled by the lectionary reading, and God works that way sometimes. As the only son among my parents' four children, I was influenced greatly by women. And now, as the husband of a pastor, the role of women in the scriptures holds even greater interest for me. So our passage begins this morning with Paul having a vision where he is asked to travel to Macedonia. Many scholars believe that Luke himself became involved at this point, accompanying Paul on his journey to the region that included Thessalonica and Philippi. Some even speculate that Luke was even the Macedonian in the vision, but there's no concrete evidence of that. However, we know Luke was involved because he switched to, he was in the first person. We went to Macedonia. We traveled there. So where exactly was Macedonia? Well, it's basically part of northern Greece. And it represents the first place outside of Asia Minor, Turkey, to which Paul and his entourage had traveled to that point in their ministry. So Macedonia is like, if you look at the map, there's the very northern part of the Mediterranean Sea. Greece is over here, looking from your direction. Greece is over here, and Turkey's over here, and the very top is where Troas was, and then right across is in Macedonia. So the trip wasn't very long, especially compared to the distance that Paul had already traveled. He'd traveled, from Jerusalem, Damascus, all the way across Turkey, a pretty large distance. So the amount that he had left to go was not very far. Probably like jumping on a boat in New Orleans and riding across the Gulf of Mexico to Tampa, something like that. Now, even though the vision had been of somebody he believed to be Macedonian, Paul felt strongly that he was being led by God, and Luke mentions that as well, that they were being led by God, despite the fact the quest didn't come directly from him, God. It came through a person in a vision. So this brings us to the first lesson from today's reading in Acts. With all the communication methods available to us, right, there are a lot of ways you receive information. Social media, not a fan. Cell phones, have to be a fan. Email, streaming devices, good old human interaction. Whatever happened to that? Many people hold the view that miracles and visions are things that were referred to in biblical times, but that we're way too far advanced to believe in such seemingly supernatural incidents. But Paul believed. After all, he'd been blinded by Jesus and had a vision of a man named Ananias coming to visit him. So Ananias showed up in Acts chapter 9, verse 17. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as we were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And this, of course, is an instrumental occurrence in the conversion of Saul, soon to go by the name of Paul. But in this case, it wasn't just Saul / Paul that believed in the visions. Ananias also believed, right? He's a key character. He's in the Bible for a nanosecond, like literally. Boom. makes this one brief appearance. It's incredibly important. Even though he was skeptical, you know, Jesus said, I want you to take this message to this guy in Damascus that I want to save and bring on board kind of thing. And Ananias says, wait. I've heard some really bad things about this guy and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he was right. Remember, Paul was present at the stoning of Stephen and his subsequent death. And that had occurred not very long at all before this incident. In fact, Stephen was stoned. Paul decided that there were a bunch of people in Damascus he could go up there and send back to Jerusalem for execution. So that's why he was on the road to Damascus when Jesus blinded him in the first place. So even with all that, Ananias goes, oh, okay, Lord, believe you. I got it. And the rest, they say, as they say, is history. So what are these visions and direct conversations with God and or Jesus? Are they real? Are they just some type of literary instrument used to tell a story in a way that would get the attention of first and second century Christians or even us today? After all, there was no technology. God couldn't run out a billboard. He couldn't post a message on Twitter. Actually, probably couldn't even if he could, because he'd probably get banned. But anyway, that's a different story. He couldn't even run an ad in a local newspaper, and he couldn't certainly go on local radio with some great voiceover artist giving the message. So what do you believe? Thomas had to put his fingers in the scars before he fully bought in, right? He's like, I don't think it's him. I need to see. We don't have that luxury. We don't get to walk around with Jesus in the flesh, post or pre-resurrection. Are you directly guided by the Holy Spirit? Or do you believe instead that there are a bunch of Ananiases running around delivering messages that they are given directly by God? Well, I believe in both. I tell you why. This is kind of a witnessing message this morning. So I've had several instances where the Holy Spirit has moved me to do things that either I didn't want to do, didn't think I was capable of, or everybody else just thought I was just plain crazy. And you could ask Rachel, she knows I'm crazy, but a different way. So in 2006, I hadn't been in Northwest Arkansas very long. I was living in Rogers. I was attending the First Presbyterian Church of Rogers. Come on, I converted. I'm a Methodist now. Don't think poorly of me. Anyway, so our pastor at the time, Jeff Parker, still a very good friend of mine. He's in New Mexico at a Presbyterian church. Parker, as we call him, had a Monday morning Bible study where he would basically use it to prepare his sermon. I often gave him a hard time for this because I said, you're just getting us all around the table and giving you sermon ideas. He goes, hey, I use what I can. So on this particular Monday morning, I hadn't been in Rogers very long. Certainly didn't know my way around the town, which is much different now than it was even back then. But he leaned across the table after I had beat my gums for a while. He leaned across the table, put his hand on the table and pointed at me and said, if you want to do more for God than just flap your gums, then go down to Meals on Wheels and start driving today. He said, we've got people we can't serve. They're going hungry. I was apprehensive. I didn't know my way around. Hadn't been there very long. Taking food to strangers? Well, I did it. I did it for 4 years, 2 days a week. For 4 years. I certainly knew my way around Rogers by the time I was done, I can tell you that much. 2010, about the time I stopped driving for Meals on Wheels, I was in the middle of a very bad personal situation. I was barely able to buy food for myself. God asked me, this was between Christmas and New Year's in 2009, and then the first Sunday of 2010 was January 2nd or 3rd or something like that. And God asked me to start a breakfast ministry at the church to feed the parents and the kids so we could get a Sunday school class going, Sunday school program going. I told Jeff about Parker about it. He said, "You're crazy." I told the session about it, and they said, "Ah, that's not a good idea." I went to Walmart. I had $100 in my checking account. Went to Walmart, spent $20 on food, cooked breakfast for 8 people. So for 9 months, the following 9 months, God chose to fund that ministry after the fact. Every Sunday I'd put out a bowl and I'd have enough money and buy the food. Until I got a job, got back on my feet, and then God said, "That it's on you now. You need to start doing your job too." Anyway, 3 years. In 3 years, that ministry, with an initial purchase of just under $20, prepared over 5,000 breakfast meals. Do I believe in feeding the 5,000? Do I believe in feeding the 4,000? Absolutely I do, because I did it. The church did it. God did it. 2019, now I'm a Methodist. I'm at Lincoln. Had a woman in our church who several Sundays in a row was trying to convince me that I needed to counsel at the local food bank called Grace Place, which is supported by 10 local churches in Western Washington County. The role involved praying for people when they came in to get food and talking to them and counseling them and listening to all their details of why they were in the situation that they were. And I just said, "It's something I can't do. I just don't know how to do that." About the same time, I took a spiritual gifts inventory as part of my lay speaker training. And one night, Rachel looked at my inventory and said, "You know what? You have the gift of compassion. You have the gift necessary to counsel and pray with people." I said, "I don't know how to pray." She goes, "Sure you do." So the next day I showed up, and for the last 3 years I've been doing that, counseling people. I'm now treasurer and secretary of that organization. God is good. And just 3 months ago, I'm semi-retired. It wasn't by choice. The corporate world decided that I was not needed there anymore. It took me a while to find something that I enjoyed doing, and I found it about 2.5 years ago. 3 months ago, it wasn't what it had been cracked up to be, and for whatever reason, even though I was enjoying it, those around me were not enjoying me enjoying it. And so God... I had filled in for Heath Williams at Decatur and grab it on that Sunday morning, and I got home and I was churning away at my deadlines. It was a sports-related writing job. And God stopped me in the middle and said, "Stop it." It was as loud as you could possibly hear. I actually had to ask Rachel if she heard something because it was loud. I said, "Okay, I got to finish my deadlines for the week and I'll stop it." He goes, "No, stop it now." Now. Immediately stopped it, got online, got out of it. It didn't end well, but I stopped it. And he also told me, though, "I got something else for you." Even Rachel said, "Hey, Spire, I got something else for you." And that's early February. By early May, there still wasn't something. So a week ago Friday, I was talking to Rachel on the phone about 9:30 in the morning, and I said, "You know, I guess I'm just, it's just a lesson in patience. God wants me to be patient. He wants me to be patient and faithful. He wants me to wait for whatever he has for me. Stop pushing a rope. I'm going to stop applying to stuff. Something's going to show up, and he's going to provide it." 45 minutes later, 45 minutes, I got an email. "So we want you to come work for us starting next Thursday. This many hours, this is it, 45 minutes. It's a great job. It's perfect. It's going to be perfect for our my home situation. So, do I believe that miracles, visions, and almost inexplicable requests are just things of the past? No way. If we truly believe in their presence, I gave my topic last week at Harmon was how after Jesus was resurrected, he came back. People didn't recognize him for a little bit. Like, they'd be like, "What's that? Guys on the road to Emmaus, the apostles in the boat, like, who's that guy?" Well, I believe that when you believe, when you truly believe in these things, and you truly believe that God will talk to you, he will talk to you. It's not just some crazy random thought. It's real. We don't always know. We don't know why. We don't know how they're going to fit into the greater plan, but God has a plan, and he talks to us. Now, later in a reading, we see another biblical character who, despite a brief appearance, has a profound effect on the growth of Christianity. So Paul travels to Philippi with Silas, Thomas, and Luke, presumably Luke. Now, Philippi had a really small Jewish population. Those of you who've done Bible study know there weren't very many Jews, at least, and there certainly weren't many male Jews. In fact, there was no synagogue, and the Jewish women were gathering by the river to pray on the Sabbath, basically hold a worship service. And this was led by Lydia. She's known by Lydia in this passage. There is speculation that Lydia was a euphemism for where she was from and what she did, and there's speculation that she's mentioned again under a different name in Paul's letter to the Philippians, but there's no verification of that either. She came from the city of Thyatira to probably run what we can assume was a successful business of selling cloth. Purple dye. Purple cloth. Expensive. Purple dye was expensive. Now, there's a bunch of things about this story that are way outside the norms of the time. Actually, they're a little bit outside the norms of today, if you really think about it. And especially for a devout Jew like Paul. Paul actually killed people in the name of Judaism. So first of all, there are no men gathered at the river for prayer. They found a group of women. If there had been men present, the women probably wouldn't have been mentioned in the first place. It's a congregation of women led by women. Second, Lydia... this is first century Europe. Lydia is successful in business and she's prominent in Philippi. She has wealth and influence. And in spite of all this, Paul and his companions are led to worship with the group. These are Jewish men worshiping with Jewish women in a country far, far away. Is that country or galaxy? We're going to go with country because there's no galaxy at the moment. They baptize them and eventually convert them to Christianity. They bring them over as believers of Christ. We also know that from Paul's letter to the Philippians, and at least from his perspective, it turns out to be one of the most faithful and successful churches that he had the honor and pleasure of visiting and writing to during his ministry. But what's even more important to consider from this initial contact with Philippi is the spirit of hospitality that Lydia and her household extend to Paul and his group. Jewish men sharing a residence for even a few hours, even today, by today's standards, it would still be kind of, what was that? Would it be considered radical, controversial? And think of Jesus with the woman at the well, how much consternation that caused among his disciples. And all he did was talk to her, get some water, and send her into town to spread the message. So these four men probably resisted this invitation pretty vehemently to begin with. Can't do that. Can't do that. That'd be like, eating unclean meat. Oh, wait, Peter did that earlier. Sorry, that one's gone too. but she prevailed upon us. So this leads us to believe that they relented only after she was insistent in her request. Imagine that, a prominent female businesswoman being insistent. Here we have Jewish women, one of them successful and prominent, converted to followers of Jesus Christ, ends up starting and continuing one of the most faithful Christian congregations in Southern Europe. Wow. This entire text is 7 verses. Think of the power of Scripture. 7 verses and all this stuff happens. It's amazing. So first, I believe there's no better example of the role of women in the life of the church. There's no mention of Paul treating them as anything but equals when it comes to spiritual matters. The very fact that the story made the Bible to begin with is incredible. And given the times and the misogynistic attitudes, so it's incredibly impactful. Second, the hospitality that Lydia extends. It's a model for all of us to follow. My mother, God rest her soul, she passed away 5 years ago next week. And one of the last things she said to me, I said, "Hey, Mom, are you ready?" She goes, "Oh, yes, I am ready." She was 95. But she said, "Remember, Kevin, remember, always err on the part of generosity. Always err on the side of generosity." So Lydia's very generous with what she has, but you know, she had to work pretty hard for that, you would expect. Had to overcome numerous obstacles. Pretty hard to do. But there's no hesitation. She's ready to give it. Opens her household to Paul and his group. And it wasn't just a surface or a superficial request or offer. She obviously really, really wanted to do it because she had to be insistent to get them to accept. You know, there's a difference. Like, "Hey, come on over for dinner tomorrow night." And somebody goes, "I'm busy." You're like, "Okay." Whew. Man, didn't have enough anyway. But this was real. And she backed it up. And finally, you're going, "Gosh, thank goodness. I got to get to lunch." Finally, going back to the beginning, and this is where this all tied up a little bit of a bow this morning. Let's go back to the beginning and the vision of the Macedonian man. What would have happened had Paul not taken the vision seriously? He may not have hooked up with Luke. His story may never have been told. Those letters might have never been written. Those churches might never have been formed. Christianity might have been stopped right there on the shores of the Mediterranean Sea. We don't know that. But it certainly wouldn't have been in Philippi. And it certainly wouldn't have been with Lydia. And it certainly wouldn't have been as strong a church as it became. God wanted that church in Philippi, and he used a vision that he knew would get the attention of Paul. He used whatever means at his disposal to get Paul's attention in a way that Paul could understand and could enact on. Give you an example. So if he'd had the vision 2,000 miles to the east, and God had said, "Hey, go to Macedonia." Wow. Be like telling you, "Just walk to Alaska and start a church." But if God said, "Drive to Clarksville and meet with some people that I have over there." You can do that. That's what he does. It was realistic for Paul to get from where he was to Macedonia. And they needed him. And he went. He didn't know what would transpire. In fact, the message was kind of, wasn't very clear, was it? What did the man say? He said, come over to Macedonia and help us. Kind of cryptic. Kind of like one of those movies you see where you see where somebody gets kind of this weird message and it's like, huh, what am I supposed to do here? But he did it. You see, we don't know where things will lead. Paul certainly didn't. God does. Pretty good idea anyway if we follow him. So in closing, the next time you hear a voice and get a nudge from somebody, it could very well be God himself, using whatever means he can to move you in his direction. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us together today spring morning. Thank you for the music and the fellowship. Thank you for being together in your name. We ask that your word fell on receptive ears this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Sealed with Christ on high.
Hear this benediction this morning. Go in peace. Open your ears, open your heart to the Word of God.